Alex Abella is the Cuban-born author of the book, Soldiers of Reason, The RAND Corporation, and the Rise of the American Empire. He was allowed exclusive access in the RAND Corporation archives. What he found was mad scientists, behaviorists, and hawkish generals who were intent on starting World War III and fleecing the American people on the way. Once he was a skeptic of the subject of conspiracy theories in the New World Order, but after his work with the RAND Corporation, he is now convinced that this top-secret think tank has been pulling the strings of American government for at least 60 years.
Hi, I'm Alex Abella. I'm the author of Soldiers of Reason, The RAND Corporation, and The Rise of the American Empire. This was a book that came out in 2008, and it basically is a history of the RAND Corporation and its influence on American history and basically, I guess, world history. In a way, what I say in the book is that we're all the bastard children of RAND, and we don't even know it. Originally, the RAND Corporation was an offshoot of the Air Force, which wanted to recreate the Manhattan Project. As you recall, the Manhattan Project was when civilians and the military got together to create the atomic bomb. After World War II ended, a general named General Henry Arnold wanted to make sure that that same combination of civilian scientists and military know-how got together so as to be able to create new weapons. They went on then to develop this particular organization, which is to be called eventually RAND, which stands for Research and Development. Now, RAND originally was supposed to be only to go into the theoretical things, sort of like developing plans for intercontinental ballistic missiles and to develop new weapons of destruction. Ultimately, it expanded into other fields. It expanded into social science, it expanded into history, it expanded above all into economics. And it got to be so big that the Air Force had to spin it off. They had sited it over at Douglas Aircraft, which was one of the biggest aircraft manufacturers in the country at the time. So in 1948, they spun it off. Now, the reason why I'm talking about all this is because from the beginning of RAND as a separate entity apart from the Air Force, that is, as its own corporation, when it becomes the RAND Corporation, it's been intrinsically linked to the Ford Foundation. If we're talking about the robber barons, if we're talking about people like Carnegie, about Ford, Rockefeller, well, yes, I mean, there has been always a link between think tanks and the big, powerful economic interests. Specifically, in the case of RAND, there has been a link between RAND and the Ford Foundation. In fact, the attorney who drafted the Articles of Incorporation for RAND was the same fellow who later became the president, the first president of the Ford Foundation. And they used to go around asking the people at RAND, are there any particular projects that you want us to fund? Without Ford money, the RAND Corporation would have never gotten off the ground. So from the beginning, there has been that that intricate, that you might say that that really intimate relationship between the two bodies, between the two ways of looking at the world, because after all, what you have here with the big economic interests is that they want to make sure that their own interests are protected. They want to make sure their goods can be sold throughout the world, and they want to make sure that we have consumers for that. And RAND, in a way, served as a very useful adjunct to that particular way of thinking. The original title for my book was RAND, The RAND Corporation and the New World Order. I did that on purpose, and I wanted to have people think about what those words actually meant. Because what RAND actually did during the 1950s is that they came up with this particular way of looking at the world that changed everything, that changed the world we live in, that changed how we think, how we talk, the schools we send our kids to, how we pay our taxes, the planes we fly in. They've changed the whole world. And that's what I'm saying, in a way, that we are the bastard children of RAND. And what do I mean by all that? They began the whole process of giving an ideological foundation to the process of deregulation that would come to a head during the Reagan administration. They developed something called rational choice theory that, after it came up and after it was developed and expanded, It turned us from citizens into consumers. And instead of having rights and responsibilities, we became consumers with choices. In a world where what really counts is what they call the consumer sovereignty, or the sovereignty of the consumer, where what counts is not what we do, or who we believe in, or what God we pray to, but how much money are we going to spend, and what's in it for me? In a way, it changed the whole physiognomy of America, and by extension, the rest of the world. Obviously, my book deals mostly with the RAND Corporation, and the Ford Foundation is sort of like an offshoot of the whole thing. But I do know that at the time that the RAND Corporation was founded, like I said, the first president of the Ford Foundation was one of the founders of the RAND Corporation. And their goals are very similar. Their goals were to have a world in which you have technocrats running everything. One of the founders of RAND, one of the main intellectual luminaries of RAND, was a fellow named John Williams, who was the head of the mathematics department. And he believed in preemptive nuclear attacks in the Soviet Union, and he believed in bringing about a one-world government that would be run by technocrats, like himself, by people who would be following what he called the rule of reason, which would be all right if only that reason was controlled by ethics. Unfortunately, neither in the world of RAND nor in the world of that Ford Foundation at the time was there much call for an ethical point of view of what our life is supposed to be all about. Instead, it was going to be a world in which efficiency was all, in which men almost became substitute machines. And if you look at the early history of RAND, matter of fact, that's one of the reasons why they went into the social sciences, because they couldn't figure out how to deal with people. People are messy. People are not rational at bottom. But the people at RAND and the people at the Ford Corporation thought that humans are rational and that what guides our actions is self-interest. Of course, you and I both know that's not the case. We love our children. We love our family. We love our country. Sometimes we are even willing to give our life for a fellow human being, even though we may not know him. Now, all those principles are denied by the doctrines of rational choice theory that came out of RAND. There's no place for that in the worldview of both the Ford Foundation and the RAND Corporation at that time of the early 50s. Humans are messy. Humans are complicated. Humans are both rational and irrational. I believe at bottom, we're all irrational, and that we use rationality as a tool to achieve ends that in and of themselves are not rational. Rational choice began as a way of countering Marxist doctrine. You may not recall this, but at the end of the Second World War, during the late 40s, early 50s, there was a great deal of pessimism in the Western world. People really thought that capitalism was going to die, basically, that communists were going to win, and that there was no way to stop the dialectical progress of humanity, so to speak, you know, to borrow some of the terminology of the communists, that there was a certain way that history developed, and that all that we could do was, you know, bend our heads and say, okay, Lord, here we go. That was not the case, obviously. But the United States had to come up with a theory that would legitimize the individualist perspective on life that the United States has always had and that Western civilization had. So there was an economist named Kenneth Arrow that was hired by the RAND Corporation to come up with what they called a utility function for the Soviet Union. The Soviet Union was a very closed society. We had some spies. We didn't have that much information about it. Basically, RAND, as the think tank for the government, was given the task of trying to decide how would the Soviet leaders act. In other words, what would Joseph Stalin do if, let's say, we were to invade Poland, or if we were to go into the Soviet section of Germany? How would they react? So therefore, they gave him this particular assignment, which was to assign what they call a utility function. How would the leaders of the Soviet Union react given a particular crisis with the Western world? So what Arrow did is that he took it from a perspective of a mathematician, and he assigned certain values to his research. And he came up with this theory called rational choice theory, whereby he postulated that it's self-interest what drives people, that humans are essentially rational, that all humans think with the same kind of rationality, that science is universal, and that we're all in it for ourselves, and that there's no such thing as religion, altruism, patriotism, that self-interest rules all, and that therefore what we should have is something called the sovereignty of the consumer, that we should give people as many choices that they can, because according to his theory, if you have a group of four people and there's more than two choices, there's never going to be a democratic decision, because one of the parties is going to impose his will on the others. Now, I know to us that sounds like nonsense, because obviously we live in a democracy of what comes as close as we can to being in one, and you know, we do believe in majority rule, but according to these axiomatic principles that Mr. Arrow developed, there is no such thing, that there's always the tyranny of a particular party over another. So therefore, in order to countervail that, and thus to countervail Marx's doctrine, he came up then with the theory of rational choice. Rational choice then became the foundation for all the deregulation that happened during the Ronald Reagan era, and even before, during Carter. Because after all, if people are only in things for themselves, then there's no such thing as a politician acting for the good of the country. So therefore, you know, it's all self-interest. So therefore, we have to do things in such a way that everybody will get the most benefit out of it. Therefore, we have to deregulate things, because we have to see what do we get out of this, and it would be unnatural to expect people to actually give things to others, because after all, that's not what human nature is all about. So that became the foundation, you know, for deregulating industries and for basically the mess that we find ourselves in. RAND obviously didn't just develop rational choice. I mean, obviously RAND was created to create new weapons of mass destruction, so to speak. So they were extremely instrumental in the development of intercontinental ballistic missiles. They were also extremely instrumental in the creation of the hydrogen bomb as well. And as the 50s went on, they were involved with NASA. Matter of fact, they were one of the first people to propose an orbiting Earth station, an orbiting satellite station around the Earth. And that was like the first project that they did back in 1946. They were also involved, very heavily involved, in the use of nuclear weapons. Why is that? Well, RAND was the creation of the Air Force. The Air Force at the time was the golden child of the military services in the United States, because they were entrusted with the ultimate weapon, the atomic bomb, and later the hydrogen bomb, because they were transported by airplanes. Intercontinental ballistic missiles had not been developed yet. So therefore, RAND was involved in this brand new form of looking at warfare. One of the first things that RAND tried to do was to come up with a theory of general warfare. Like a theory of how warfare should be applied, what should be done, and of course, you know, it didn't work, because there's no such thing as a general theory of warfare. There might be something like that in physics, but certainly not in war. So therefore, that went, you know, I went by the wayside. So therefore, what RAND began to do is to do special localized studies. And one of the things that they did was called the basing study, which highlighted how the United States would have been susceptible to a sneak Soviet attack that would have destroyed our country, basically. Would have destroyed not only our planes sighted in Europe with all the nuclear weapons, but they would have been able to come in under the radar, and just like the Japanese did in Pearl Harbor, they would have been able to attack the United States. Because of studies that were done out of RAND, especially by one of its foremost researchers, a guy named Albert Wohlstetter, the United States Air Force changed the way in which its nuclear airplanes were sighted, and in which the bases were done. And therefore, it changed the way in which nuclear bombs and nuclear weaponry were handled. Not only that, they also developed